Welcome, my friends, to the Sage Quay Radio Hour, your home for free and critical thinking, and I'm your host, Mike Williams. Today, my very special guest is Richard Balducci. Richard is an expert in astrology and the occult. He joins me to share his research and insights into the level of occultism that permeates the Beatles story. And so without further ado, here's the conversation with Richard. Well, folks, we have a great show this afternoon. Richard Balducci is with us today. Richard is heavily into the occult. He's an expert in the occult. And I also mentioned in my recent interviews that I work with a loose group of 5 to 6 open source investigators. And Richard is one of my sources that has helped me a lot with regard to understanding the occult aspects of the Beatles story. And so today we're going to get into some heavy duty stuff. And I mentioned to Richard before the show got started that we might wind up doing a part 2 or part 3. Because there is a lot of information for us to understand. Although Memoirs covers the occult aspects of the Beatles, Richard's going to do a deep dive. And that deep dive is going to get us to really understand what really went on. And so, Richard, with that very long introduction, I want to thank you very much for accepting my invite to come on the show and to talk about your work. Because as I've mentioned, you have been a tremendous help in getting me to understand this whole occult piece of the Beatles.
Thank you, great Sage. Your show has taken the Paul is Dead research light years from where it was. And I think today we're going to go into hyperspace on it. I mean, no one is ever going to look at the Beatles the same innocent way after this production.
One of the things I wanted to ask you is, I know you and I talked about this in some of our other dialogues that obviously was not part of the show, but how did you wind up getting into looking into the occult and the Beatles? How did you get there?
I used to own a tabloid that was all cartoons called Snicker. And it just blew up large cartoons. And it was an underground paper. And it always got me in trouble. And one of the ways it got me in trouble was with Anheuser-Busch, a 7-year court thing. We went to the Supreme Court, but they weren't home. And then when Pope John Paul II came to St. Louis, the CIA or whoever, his security, told me I had to remove my newspaper boxes from his room. And I was like, well, if I went to Rome, I wouldn't ask him to, you know, take statues down because I'm coming, you know. I tried the whole First Amendment thing, but basically the security just cut the chains and moved the boxes, you know. And so to make a long story bearable, I was like, what is it with this Pope guy, you know? And I used to be an altar boy. And so I knew the ritual. But I didn't really know much about the Vatican. Well, then I find out the Vatican is built on the field of the Vates, who are soothsayers, basically witches. You know, well, that's interesting. The root word of Vatican, Vati, means a soothsayer or witch. Well, what do you know about that? And then, of course, the obelisks went to great pains to move this obelisk to the middle of St. Peter's Square. And the Pope at the time, it took like a year or whatever to move it from the circus they had there. The Pope told when they were taking the obelisk down and then when they were putting it up later on, he said he wanted total silence, that if anybody said anything during the sacred moment of taking the obelisk down and putting the obelisk back up, that they would be killed right on the spot. And they had a gallows right there. You know, they weren't kidding around. So when they got the obelisk almost upright, the ropes started to break. And these were hemp ropes, by the way. So, you know, heroes of marijuana out there. It took the strength of hemp ropes to raise the obelisk, and somebody shouted out, aqua, you know, aqua, which meant water the ropes. And they did, and instead of the rope snapping, it saved the whole day. And instead of the guy being put to death, they had a big feast for him, a whole barge thing every year. You know, it was a real big deal. He was like this big hero. I'm sorry, I can't remember his name. But that's what got me into the whole thing was through the Vatican. And I realized when I started doing astrology, astronomy, they're really two sides of the same coin. See, astrologers turn up their nose at astronomers because they think they don't know everything. And astronomers get all snooty with astrologers because they think it's all, you know, abba-dabba. But really, all astrology is a symbolic language. That's all that they're conveying to you with the positions of the stars and the planets in different constellations and all that. But the astronomy is more the geometry and, you know, what this planet is light years from us and all this stuff. I started noticing pretty quick that a lot of the big events that happen, especially with the popes and the Vatican, they're all timed. And I soon found out that not only was Pope John Paul I murdered, which a lot of people had speculated about, because he was only there from the last quarter moon to the next last quarter moon, I think 33 days. Pope John Paul II, I found out, he was born May 18th, 1920, not only on the day of a solar eclipse, he was born during the solar eclipse. And most solar eclipses only last about 7 minutes or so. You know, a lunar eclipse can last a long time, but a solar eclipse is very quick. So to come into this life at the moment of darkness when the dead moon covers the living sun and then it casts an obelisk, shadow that actually physically stabs the earth. The shadow makes contact with the earth during totality. So that was something. And then I find out the day that Karol Wojtyła, he was later to become Pope John Paul II, he became Archbishop of Krakow, Poland on December, whatever it was, 1963. I'll think of it in a minute. It's in my book. But that was the day of a lunar eclipse. So then he just happens to get dead after he becomes Pope at 9:37 p.m., April the 2nd of that year. That was 1 week to the second before a rare hybrid solar eclipse, where basically 7 days later, after they made him dead and they did this whole week-long ritual behind the scenes, when they planted him in his tomb beneath St. Peter's Basilica in his crypt, that was the moment of totality of the annular solar eclipse that just so happens to look like a halo in the sky. You know, nice touch. Then I do more research, and I'm sorry to, you know, go on and on here, but the thing that really woke me up was not just the timing of all this stuff, but the fact that the guy who killed him as part of the ritual, I name his name. If you want to bleep it out, you know, go ahead. Cardinal Eduardo Martinez Somolo. It's on like page 134 of my book. I have his picture. I say this is the guy that killed him. I even sent a copy to the Vatican press office. I never heard back from him. Well, anyway, it's real easy to kill somebody when the murderer who hit him on the head with a silver hammer, by the way, and calls out, "Are you dead yet?" three times. The guy, you know, the Pope's 86 years old. I say hitting an 86-year-old man on the head with a hammer, asking him if he's dead yet, you know, that could be taken as murder. So anyway, the guy that did that, he's in charge of the death certificate. He's in charge of the election for the next Pope. He's in charge of the ballots. Only he sees them. And when they're counted, he says, "Nah, we ain't got a winner yet. Go back." You know, he is in charge of the crime scene. He closed the whole, you know, where the pontiff, his quarters. And, you know, I'm not sure where the ritual took place, but I know about six or seven of the people who were there. And they pass this silver hammer around and make them all do it, because that way they're all guilty and they're all going to be quiet about it. You know, nobody's going to rat anybody out. So then this guy, he's in charge until the next Pope takes over. And that was Joseph Ratzinger, the former Hitler Nazi youth. Amazing. That's an amazing career arc. So he becomes Pope. And the moment the pallium is placed on his neck in St. Peter's Square, And the moment that all the senior cardinals had finished kissing his ring was the moment of totality of a lunar eclipse, at the exact moment he becomes Pope Benedict XVI. Now, the lunar eclipse was not at the Vatican. It was on the opposite side of the Earth, which I found out means when there's a lunar eclipse on the opposite side of the Earth, it somehow through the geometry of light casts a like pyramid of light on the opposite side of the Earth. So where the ceremony was going, I guess, was a little bit brighter that day.
Very interesting. And one of the things, Richard, as I've gotten into this with your help and reading a bunch of books that I've gotten into, is that the occult is very, very much aligned with cosmology, with the sun, with the moon.
Oh, totally.
Yeah, it's amazing. And it's probably one of the reasons why they have relegated astrology to reading horoscopes in a newspaper in order to keep people from focusing on it. So they've moved away from astrology. They don't want anybody to know that. And they give us astronomy.
Right. And even I've heard large corporations employ astrologers, you know, just, you know, they're looking for any edge they can get.
Right. Right.
But everything, I mean, even the birth of the United States is an occult ritual, because the sacred star that the ancient Egyptians worshipped was called Sept, as in Sept Ember, which is a burnt piece of charcoal, 11th. And the thing about this sacred star is it's the only red, white, and blue star that we know of, and it's the star that the sun is exactly conjunct 13 days after the summer solstice, which is the 4th of July. And of course, the main hieroglyphs for the sacred star are an obelisk alongside a dome, a half circle, and a five-pointed star determinative, they called it. And the obelisk spelled out SP, and the half circle was the letter T in the ancient Egypt. So that's why on September 11th in New York, they replaced the Twin Towers, number 11, with a 1, which the Freedom Tower looks like an obelisk.
Right.
You know, on all sides. And in fact, not only that, but you know how they made waterfall fountains out of the destroyed Twin Towers?
Yes.
And then they have the, it's called Tower One or whatever. Building One is built over Ground Zero. So you've got the one and the zero. And then the layout of the new Freedom Tower with those two footprints that are now fountains mimics the stars of Orion's belt that point right at the sacred star. And not only that, like a little extra twist of the knife, the dimensions of the waterfall footprints are the same exact dimensions of the black cube at Mecca, which is all Saturn worship.
Yes. What we're trying to say here, what you're telling us, is that the symbols that they put out there, the occulted messages, are very, very calculated. It's not coincidental. There is definite rhyme and reason to how they go about their business in running the reality, right?
Right. Like you said, we're too profane to know this stuff. It means we're not antisocial psychopaths, you know, if that's what that means, then I'm profane. Yeah, I dig it.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Now, one of the things I wanted to get into, Richard, is, let me make sure I got this pronounced correctly, archaeo-occultology?
Archaeocultology. Archaeocultology.
Okay.
You need a few beers in you before it sounds right.
Okay. So what is that?
It's simply studying the positions of the stars and the planets in relation to historical events on Earth. And then you're looking at timing of events. You're looking at the days they happen on, and just facts. Archaeocultology doesn't deal with anything except facts. And then from these facts, you usually will see a bigger picture that you can stand back and then do some deductive reasoning and, you know, use your intuition and whatever tools else you got. A lot of people are archaeocultologists, but they don't know it yet. You need an ephemeris, and I have four of them. I have one for midnight and one for noon, for the last century and now the current century. And then anything really going to mid 1800s, you have to do online, like with a Swiss ephemeris, I think it's called, because even the libraries don't go back that far.
What's an ephemeris?
An ephemeris is just one of these books here. This is what it looks like. E-P-H-E-M-E-R-I-S. All it is, I don't know if you can see that too good.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't look like anything. But it was because of this that I realized, you know, I looked up the 4th of July. What's going on there? And then I see, you know, it opened up a bigger picture. But it's basically just, it's the map that they're all using. You know, these black magic occultists that plan all these things.
Okay. All right. So I learned something new today.
It's really vital. If you have one of those, the whole universe opens up to you. They really can't hide anything once you kind of see how they're operating.
Okay. Now, we talked a little bit about the solar eclipses and the lunar eclipses. So when we talk about the sun, the moon, Saturn, sometimes we'll hear things like the black sun, the sacred star. What does all that stuff mean from an occult perspective?
Okay, start with the sacred star. We talked about it a little bit. That's Sep Sothis Sirius. The Egyptians called it Sep. The Greeks called it Sothis, as in so this. And we worship it as Sirius A. Sirius A has a dark companion star called Sirius B, whose surface is harder than diamonds, they say, the scientists. And it actually is like a vampire. It's sucking energy off of the main star, Sirius A. That's the one with the hieroglyphs. And in the ancient Egyptian texts and stuff, and on the walls of tombs, they would show Isis along with her dark-headed sister, Nephthys. So that's the whole Sirius A, Sirius B. And the Dogon tribe in Africa actually believe that there is a Sirius C out there, also a dark star. I don't know about that. They might be right, because they knew about it pretty much more than anybody. They said they were told about it by, you know, visitors that came here. So, you know, I don't know what they're smoking over there in, you know, those tribes, but somebody told them. They found out somehow. And of course, they knew it in ancient Egypt, which is pretty much where all the knowledge comes. When their sacred star, Sept, would disappear for 70 days each year, because when the sun gets too close to it in the sky, you know, you can't see it in the daytime sky for 70 days. But that's why the Egyptian kings and pharaohs were mummified over a 70-day period. And then when the sacred star reappears after 70 days of being invisible, it appears for exactly 60 seconds right before the sun comes up. And because of the rising sun on Earth, it makes the sacred star, which is normally blue and white, appear red for 60 seconds when it reappears. So, you know, that's a real big metaphysical deal to the occultists.
And what about the black sun? We hear a lot about black sun rising. What exactly is the black sun?
Well, Hitler was an expert on the black sun. The black sun is actually Saturn with an asterisk. There's a lot of detail on the black sun out there, like the black sun hexagon that appears behind James Paul McCartney in that And I Love Her video.
Right.
Two of them, one behind, one he's standing on. When you take a square and you hold it up like a diamond, a square, it looks like a hexagon. So the square hexagon is basically the same as a circle squared. You've heard about the circle squared and all that?
Yep.
So, it you know, one form is kind of sometimes another hidden, you know.
Okay, this might explain, too, why NASA will show pictures of Saturn, and they'll show at the very top the pole as a hexagon.
Right. And supposedly there's an eye on the South Pole.
Yeah.
They say, or there is, and there's a storm that actually forms a hexagon on top. It's amazing. Now, when Hitler was born, his natal sun, our sun, was at 0 degrees Taurus. The same as Queen Elizabeth II, even though she was born a day later on the calendar, astronomically, they're born at identical times, 0 degrees Taurus. And then his black sun, Saturn, was located at 13 degrees Leo. The reason that's significant is because when the day of Hiroshima got nuked, even though Hitler didn't have anything to do with that, the sun itself was at 13 degrees Leo, which is where Adolf Hitler's black sun was located on the day he was born.
What's the significance of the sun and the moon? You mentioned the solar eclipses. I mean, why are these so important to the occultists?
Well, our sun has a mass, the scientists say, that equals 333,000 Earth masses. And then the sacred star is twice the mass of our sun. So that gives us 666,000 Earth masses for Sirius A. And then I think I sent you something about the combined mass of Sirius A and B. Basically, if you take the mass of the sun, 333,000, and then multiply it by 3.2, you'll get a number. And then from that number, if you divide that number of the combined mass of Sirius A and B by the address of the White House, 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, if you divide it by 1600, you'll get 666 again. I mean, it's uncanny.
You know, when I first got into this, I really thought to myself, this is not believable. But the more you dig in, the more you realize that how calculated it all is, how totally immersed our reality is in occulted knowledge, in the mysteries. It's just amazing to me. It really, really is. But the number of people, Richard, I have found that actually will take the time to even try to understand this at a base level is few and far between. Most people just bypass this stuff. And, you know, I've had discussions with some folks that do pay attention to this. They will say, look, you know, if you don't pay attention to it, then you're missing a major, major piece of how the world works and your understanding of your reality. It's very daunting. I will admit that, folks. There's a lot of knowledge that you have to try to ram into our heads. But to understand just the basic pieces of it, it really starts to make sense.
Well, here's another one. The whole alphabet itself, the English alphabet, is like a cryptogram. I don't think I sent you this information. This might be a little hard to picture, but if you draw a circle and then do all capital letters, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, all the way around the circle, you'll notice that there are groups of symmetrical letters, like A is exactly the same. If you hold it to a mirror, it'll look the same. And then asymmetrical letters, a T will be symmetrical. But anyway, my point is the numbers pi and phi are both represented in the groupings of the symmetrical numbers. If you draw a circle around all the ones that are symmetrical and count the group numbers, it'll give you either pi or phi, and they both go the other way. It's amazing. You know, 1.618 is phi, and then pi is 3.1416. Do it sometime when you're just by yourself. Draw the circle, and it has to be all capital letters, and you'll see that somebody encoded it. It's like even if you just draw a capital A, you're drawing a pyramid with the capstone missing. If you draw a capital B, you're actually drawing the number 13. You're just squeezing the numbers together.
Yeah, amazing. So we hear a lot about in the news, or we did. It's kind of faded. Intermittently, it comes back about ISIS and then others who have looked into Egyptian mysteries. We'll talk about Osiris and Horus and the obelisk. You know, the obelisk is something that is extremely pervasive. And although most people who are in the truth community understand the obelisk is symbolic of something, I have found that most don't really understand what it really means. So I was wondering if you could take us through Osiris, Isis, Horus, and the obelisk.
Okay, I'll give you the quick version. Now, some of the myths will say one thing or say another, but essentially the myth is that Osiris was married to Isis, who was his sister. All the mummies are interwoven, just like our American presidents, apparently. They're all the big same family. Osiris was murdered by his brother Set, or Seth, S-E-T-H. Sometimes you don't pronounce the H, sometimes you do. Anyway, Set is the diabolical Satan character of the Egyptian texts. So he murders Osiris, and he supposedly cuts his body into 14 pieces, and he scatters the body parts all over ancient Egypt. Well, wherever poor Osiris's wife and sister Isis found one of his body parts, she supposedly built a temple to her husband, and she couldn't find his Wiener Schnitzel. And what happened was apparently Set threw it into the Nile, and three reptile fishes gobbled it up. So she got all the other parts together with Anubis, the jackal-headed dog of embalming, and through magical rites, and because Isis created the first obelisk to represent the penis of the first dying and resurrection king, then supposedly the obelisk, through magical rites, got her knocked up, and Isis gave birth to Horus. And then Horus grows up and learns about what his evil uncle did to his father, and he didn't take that kindly. So they get in an aerial battle, and the son murders the evil uncle Set, but Horus loses an eye in the conflict. And that's why we have all these celebrities doing the one eye look, you know, all over the place. Even the Beatles, you know, way back on that album cover.
Yep. Okay. All right. So that explains a lot why we have the obelisk and the one-eyed symbolism, because a lot of folks, again, they see it. They know it is representative of the Illuminati or the Pyramid of Power, but they don't understand why it's important. You just explained that.
Well, that's where horizon comes from, or hours in the day. You know, it's all encoded.
Let me see here. We have examples of archaeocultology.
You're getting better.
Am I getting better?
Archaeocultology.
So you have examples of that. We have an outline here, folks. I want to make sure I cover all this. And the first example that you have is the United States of America.
Yeah, it's totally a ritual. I think we covered it a bit, you know, with the whole landing on Plymouth Rock on the winter solstice in 1620, when they could have waited a few days and stepped on the continent, the brand new continent that other people were already living on, when the day of the sun being born. You would think that's, you know, that's what you want to do. But there's all kinds of examples. I mean, Paris, the original name for the city of light was called Par Isis, meaning for Isis. Interestingly, when Adolf Hitler was just given Paris the city of light, because they didn't want it to be destroyed, they just so happened to give it to the sun god Adolf Hitler on the day of the summer solstice in 1940. You know, whenever anybody was saying Heil Hitler, they're basically proclaiming Hitler as a sun god. Heil, Helios was the Greek name for the sun.
And the swastika.
And the bent cross, swastika. Yes, excellent. Oh, where were we?
Okay, we were talking about the United States of America.
Oh, I'm sorry we got all the way across the pond there. A major one was the first three atomic bombs. That's a doozy. The first bomb was the one they detonated at the Trinity test site north of Alamogordo, New Mexico. Alamogordo, Allah the Father. And they didn't have a name for that one. They said they just called it the Gadget, G-A-D-G-E-T. But if you look up in a dictionary, the word Gad, G-A-D, is like an old German name for God or Gott, you know, G-O-T-T. Gad is another name for God. So you have the Alamogordo, God the Father is the test bomb. Then they truck another one over to Hiroshima, when the sun happens to be 13 degrees Leo on top of it, and they set that one off. That one they called Little Boy.
Yep.
So there you have God the Father and God the Son. And then the third one they were really clever with. The third atomic bomb just so happened to detonate or implode. It does both at the same time. Right over the largest Catholic church in the entire Orient, Urakami Cathedral. And inside, at the time of the atomic bomb at Nagasaki, there were two priests, Catholic priests, hearing confessions. So that's where you get the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, the priests who were hearing the confessions during the third atomic bomb.
Wow, I didn't know that. Very interesting.
And another thing, Hiroshima is 33 degrees north of the equator, where the first bomb, the gadget was set off at the Trinity test site is 33 degrees north of the equator. President of the United States at that time was Harry S. Truman. He was the 33rd president, and he was a 33-degree Mason. And there's a bunch of other 33s and 13s. Another touch, the plane, the Enola Gay, had a 6.5-hour flight from Tinian Island to drop the bomb, 6.5 hours back. That's 13. You've got 13 crew members on board, although in the official photograph, they don't show all 13. The Kennedy assassination, that's another one. If you look at Dealey Plaza from the sky or a map, they drove him into an inverted pyramid with the capstone missing where the railroad tracks cut across. And then he's killed at a 45 degree on the north side of the road after the car comes to a stop on top of it. The whole Zapruder film itself is a forgery. They do this right in front of the oldest Masonic temple in Dallas. It's right there. And they actually kill him between two obelisks. There's an obelisk right at Dealey Plaza, and then there's another one in the background down the road. And when they do this, they did it during a blue moon month, which means there were two full moons that month. And Diana, the goddess of the moon and the goddess of the hunt, you know, that's a little symbolism there. And another nice touch for that was the fact that on that day, November 22nd, you know, you got your 33 there, 11 and 22.
Right.
The north node, it was exactly conjunct the sacred star at 13 degrees Cancer. That's where the sacred star Sepsothis Sirius is. Now, what the node is, during a day, a 24-hour period, there's two parts from our perspective on Earth looking up at the path of the sun across the sky. Well, the path of the sun and the moon, they cross. Twice a day, they cross. And the north crossing, they call the dragon's head. And the south crossing is called the dragon's tail. And so those are key little times, too. So having the dragon's head exactly conjunct the sacred star when you're basically doing a killing of the king ritual in front of everybody is quite alarming. And then you get into the whole Zapruder film. Even though it's a massive forgery, the people, by the way, in the background, I want to tell you about the frame number in case I get off track here. Remind you, if you look at the beginning of the Zapruder film, there's people, a group of people standing to the left of the camera. Nobody waves or nothing. They're like, they could be cardboard cutouts. I don't think they were cardboard cutouts. I think they were just inserted photographically, just some people standing there. But the main point is, when the car gets to right before the headshot, you see this background where it's just grass, you know, and people, and you see their shadows. Well, first of all, the shadows in the background don't match the shadows in the car. The shadows in the background are real long, and the shadows in the car are right at 12:30, basically high noon. Even more alarming, and it gives away the phoniness of the Zapruder film, is the people in the background on the grass should be smaller than the people in the foreground, right? And then the camera's even further back. But the people in the background are 130% larger than the people in the car.
Yeah, so the whole film was doctored. I know it was doctored at least from the perspective of missing frames. They ripped frames out.
Right.
That I know.
Professor, I guess he's not a professor anymore, but to me, he'll always be a professor. James Fetzer,
yeah.
He's done, and his team have done amazing work identifying the shooters, where they were, yada, yada. You know, he has a couple of little things off. I don't remember what they were, but they were real minor. He's got it nailed. He's the man on that topic.
Yeah, I've done shows with not with with Jim Fetzer, but with Robert Morningstar and Ole Damegaard on the Kennedy assassination, and it's very, very interesting and extremely intriguing. Another situation where the public was sold a bag of lies that to this day is still the official story, even though when you take a look at it, you should come to the realization that it's a fairy tale.
Those frames, they even printed a bunch of them in Life magazine, and you know, it's still there. They can't fake it now.
Yeah, it's there. Now, you mentioned in your email to me the UPC product barcode. I found that one interesting. What's that about?
Oh, that's a goodie. That was designed by a gentleman named George J. Lauer for IBM, as the story goes, around 1971. And then by 1973, they started putting it on all the products. Well, it turns out the UPC product barcode actually has two hemispheres. It has a left hemisphere and a right hemisphere. There's always two barcodes of varying thickness per number. But the thing is, a 0 through 9 on the left side of the barcode system will not match the 0 through 9 barcode combination on the right. However, we can cut through all that because a right-sided 6 is the only barcodes that are the two thin lines. That's the only one that's two thin lines. And there's a thing called, he termed it guard bars, where the first bar, the middle bar, and the last bar that bracket everything together are just slightly longer than all the other barcodes, and they just happen to be 666.
Interesting. That's something else I didn't know.
Amazing how those numbers do that without anybody doing it intentionally.
What about 9/11? I've done some interviews with Michael Joseph, who's done some great work on the occult aspects of 9/11. In your email to me, you mentioned 9/11 before 9/11. What does that mean?
Oh, well, that just means the dress rehearsal. That was the Oklahoma City bombing.
Yep.
Looking back now with 2020 hindsight, I think we can all determine that that was a dress rehearsal.
Yep.
And maybe some things didn't quite go right, and there were still bombs inside, supposedly. And then the ATF is supposedly there before, you know, they're having a drill. Amazing on these, all these things where they have drills, where something is taken as the real thing, like that Boston Marathon bombing on the 15th again, was it? 14th, 15th? But the finish line at the Boston Marathon bombing happens to be 666 Boylston Street.
Yeah.
And supposedly they were doing a drill there too. That's all part of the hocus pocus focus.
Now, how about the satanic ritual sacrifice of Sharon Tate? Because you had mentioned to me before we got started that this was really the segue into you looking into the Beatles.
Yeah, poor Sharon. I started looking at her filmography, and I discovered that her filmography only consists of 13 acting performances. Or maybe a better, more correct way would be to say Sharon Tate's filmography consists of 13 acting contracts. Because she did appear a couple of times on different Beverly Hillbillies episodes. But if you count them out, she did 13. Now, the first movie that she had a speaking major part in just so happened to be called Eye of the Devil, which came out in 1966. And then her last movie that was released shortly after her ritual murder was called The 13 Chairs, but they retitled it to 12 plus 1. I guess they thought that that was more tasteful. And then that whole thing ties into the day that Eye of the Devil was released in 1967, April 24th, there was a lunar eclipse on that day. You start getting into some weirdness there.
What's the significance, Richard, of 13? Why did the occultists focus on 13 so much?
Well, the occultists for the United States really focused on it, I suppose, because that's where the sacred star was on July the 4th, 1776. So that's kind of our focus on it. And what that tells me is the United States was founded for a specific purpose. And I think that purpose is, this is speculation here, but you know, when they sacrifice something, whether it's President Kennedy or James Paul McCartney, they sacrifice the best. And Sharon Tate was about the best looking gal you would ever want to see. And she didn't even wear makeup. So she was a natural beauty who was pregnant. And then, of course, she's ritually murdered. And her and Jay Sebring starred in that first movie together, Eye of the Devil. And those were the only two people who were butchered at that house that Roman Polanski and Sharon Tate shared that had nooses around their necks. And that was some kind of either Masonic or witchcraft symbol with that. You know, I'm still looking into that. But they were the only two. Everybody else that was cut up didn't have a noose around them. So that was some, you know, meaning. Kind of like when that Supreme Court Justice Scalise got dead, but he had the pillow over his face, you know.
Right, right.
Because that, you know, that happens a lot where people will die with a pillow on their face.
So the Sharon Tate murders were an occult ritual then?
If they weren't, the only way they couldn't be would be if it was a false flag and they wanted us all to think that a big massacre and then everybody went into the witness protection or whatever. Because the whole point of that with 2020 hindsight, it was a couple of weeks or so or three after the fake NASA moon landings. So they needed something big for all the three networks at the time to talk about. So nobody would talk about. You know, that kind of looked a little fake, some of that, you know, moon stuff, you know. And now other people have done great work where they've blown up NASA images of the supposedly lunar lander on the surface of the moon.
Right.
And the thing looks like it was made at Central Hardware with like tin and stuff that's not even riveted. All there's buckles in it.
Yeah. Curtain rods and such. Yeah. All right. Now with Sharon Tate. There is linkages, obviously, between Tate, Charles Manson and the Beatles, right?
Right. Well, keep in mind, Sharon Tate was killed in Bel Air. There's that again. The age of 26. So she's 13 plus 13 years old on top of it. She was in Rosemary's Baby, but she didn't have a speaking part. She played just one of the good looking chicks at the party scene. But anyway, Angela Dorian in Rosemary's Baby, she also goes by the name Victoria Vetri. I'm not sure which name she's using now. She was a Playboy Playmate of the Year in 1966, who was also in Rosemary's Baby. And she plays the girl who supposedly either committed suicide or met a nefarious end right in front of the archway of the Dakota building, which in the movie is called the Bramford. But it's actually the exact spot where John Lennon was murdered 13 years later. There's only two times in that movie, all of Rosemary's Baby was shot on sound stages at Paramount Pictures, except for two scenes. The scene right where, outside of the Dakota, where, you know, they find out the girl got dead there. And then the very last shot of the movie, when the camera is fading up slowly and away like a departing soul, it's right at the exact spot where John Lennon was murdered 13 years later.
Okay. I didn't know that either.
And then here's another one. John Lennon was murdered on December 8th, 1980. On December 8th, 1967, here's a couple more occult signatures, because keep in mind that's 13 years to the day before John Lennon gets dead. The Rolling Stones released their album for their Satanic Majesty's Request, something like that.
Right.
That album actually has pictures of the four Beatles in separate little circles on it.
Right.
And then on that same date, the Beatles, or the Cheatles by then, with False Paul, they released the album Magical Mystery Tour, and I believe that came out 13 years to the day before John Lennon's killed.
The other thing that I've said to folks on the shows, Richard, as you know, is that the planning for these rituals or for these events, whatever you want to call them, they're way in advance. So It's not like they wake up on a particular day and say, oh, we're going to do this. There is rhyme and reason. There's a sequencing that goes way back.
Here's a frightening thought. John Lennon was born 66 years to the day after an eclipse. And his mother, Julia, was born on the day of a lunar eclipse. And Julia just so happened to live to be 44 years old plus 4 months plus 4 days old. And she's killed by a policeman.
Yeah.
A lot of these people on the periphery of the Beatles seem to meet ends with policemen.
Yeah. Yeah. Mal Evans.
Mal Evans. And that's the most tragic. I mean, well, they're all tragic, but even Heather Mills, she lost her leg because of a policeman.
Yeah, it's very, very, it's disconcerting and a little uncomfortable sometimes. You really start to think about how all this works. Now, we wanted to talk a little bit about how this all plays into the Beatles, and we'll get into the whole McCartney thing. But one of the items you mentioned in your email was John Lennon had to leave Cynthia Lennon and the reasoning behind that.
I finally understand it. And it's a very, very sad reason. And if you were in therapy, a therapist would understand this, but here goes. Cynthia Lennon, John Lennon's first wife, Cynthia Powell, was born on September 10th, 1939 in Blackpool. Imagine you're John Lennon for a second, and your best friend and songwriting partner that you've gone on this amazing journey with gets dead on September 11th. And now you got to act happy the day before for your wife's birthday. So whatever problems they were having, you know, and John was, you know, being John, he couldn't even do it one time. He split long before her birthday came up again. John Lennon, he was pretty much a down to earth guy. And the agony of him probably had thinking, I got to put on a song and dance and sing happy birthday and, you know, act all glad when my heart was ripped out, you know, by my best friend and mate, you know, within hours of her birthday.
Yeah. So you think he left because he just couldn't deal with the date?
I think that was not the main thing, but it was the final thing that was like, I got to get out of here. And then of course he meets Yoko Ono, the witch, on November 9th. Which is 9/11 backwards.
Right.
And that's also a play on where Brian Epstein first met the Beatles at noon at the Cavern Club on November 9th, you know, 9/11 backwards. So 5 years to the day after Brian Epstein met the Beatles, Yoko Ono comes on the scene at the Indigo Art Gallery. Indigo is the last color in the color spectrum that's visible before indigo turns into black. So that whole indica gallery apparently was a hive of witchcraft, because didn't Jane Asher's brother, wasn't he a part owner of that?
I believe he was, yeah.
Peter Asher. And then there's a couple other guys that I couldn't find anything on of the other co-owners on when they were born or when they died. They're hushing that up for some reason. But Peter Asher was born on the summer solstice when the sun was 0 degrees Cancer. So that also, and also the black sun was 0 degrees Cancer on the same summer solstice day, June 22nd, 1944, that Peter Asher was born. So when he was born, the black sun was exactly conjunct the yellow sun. And they're both 13 degrees away from the sacred star, which is at 13 degrees Cancer. It just goes on and on.
There's two things that I've noticed, Richard. I think you might have maybe saw this video that I put up about the monkeys premiering on September 12th, 1966, so one day after biological Paul's death.
Yes, that is highly significant. It's another one of those things that by itself, it doesn't mean much.
It was because of Peter Tork's death. I looked into it, and then I saw the date when the monkeys premiered, and I thought to myself, well, that's very odd. A day after the death of Paul McCartney. And for the audience, Richard, we will get into the significance of September 11th. So we're not there yet, but we will explain, or Richard will explain it to us. I know there's a lot of debate about whether it was August or September 11th or November 9th, but we will get into September 11th in short order. Just bear with us.
The whole thing about the Beatles, too, we can't forget that after John F. Kennedy got dead, the Beatles came to the United States exactly 77 days after the JFK assassination. And this was something I just discovered this morning when I woke up and had hot tea. The Beatles made their television debut, their live television debut on Granada Television's People and Places show. And that was only broadcast in the north and northwest of Great Britain. That was October 17th, 1962. Well, the Beatles' first live television appearance comes on Granada Television exactly 77 months plus 7 days after Granada TV first had their premiere date, which was May the 3rd, 1956. So there's a bunch more sevens right there that goes with the 77 days coming to America.
Yeah. The other thing I've noticed, Richard, I'll just throw this out there. I haven't discussed it with you, and I haven't actually spoken to anybody about it, but I was taking a look at Bill's son, James, and his birth date is September 12, 1977. So he's born a day after September 11th and 11 years after biological Paul's year of death. We have 111.
Wow. It sounds like they planned that pregnancy pretty good. I'm surprised they didn't in vitro him and pull him out a little early, but, you know, that's a mind blower. But, you know, see, that fits right in because you remember when little Prince George was born to William and Kate? I forget what year it was, but when he was born on that day, Mars, the planet of war, was exactly conjunct Jupiter, which is known as the king of the planets. And that was the same type of situation when supposedly bin Laden got dead.
Yeah.
You remember when the U.S. government heroically found bin Laden, killed bin Laden, identified that it was bin Laden, did the DNA test on bin Laden, got the DNA test back on bin Laden the same day they killed him, and then buried him at sea the same day. When has the government ever worked that quickly on anything, unless it's to kill somebody?
Right.
So on that day that supposedly bin Laden got killed, the same thing. The planet of war was exactly conjunct the king of the planets, and it was on May the 1st on top of it, the satanic holiday. I guess we should explain that real quick since we're on it.
Yeah, please do.
The whole thing about the satanic holiday has to do with the witch's Sabbath on April 30th and the satanic holiday on May the 1st, May Day. It's known as Beltane, Great Fire Festival. There's a maypole, by the way, on Paul McCartney's new cover. We'll talk about that later.
Okay.
But here's the thing about the importance of the Walpurgis night, Witches' Sabbath, and April 30th and May the 1st. At that time of the Gregorian calendar year, which was created by Pope Gregory the 13th, nice touch, one-third of the Gregorian calendar season year is over, and that leaves two-thirds of the Gregorian calendar remaining. So one-third is 0.333, which is in harmony with the mass of the sun, and then two-thirds is 0.666, which is in harmony with the sacred star, Sepsothis Sirius. They're very clever in the short term and the long term planning out, but they can't hide everything like they used to. And now they still tell the same lies about stuff, but, you know, we know it for what it is now.
Yeah, more and more people are clearly waking up to what's going on. Let's get into this now. A lot of people are very uncomfortable whenever the premise that biological Paul McCartney, James Paul McCartney's death, was a satanic ritual. Now, in the memoirs of Billy Shears, especially in the second book, The Blue Book, Billy tells us through Tom that this is indeed what happened, that in 1962, both Paul and John engaged in an occult ritual. It was overseen by occultists and handlers to ensure that the ritual took place, and that the purpose of that ritual, Bill refers to it as death for success. Right. So in other words, they give their life for the success of the Beatles. And with that, starting in 1962, the Beatles have this exponential explosion in fame and fortune and just becoming the greatest rock band of all time. So whenever we talk about Paul McCartney and we put it in the context of a satanic ritual, a lot of people get very, very upset. I've had people, you know, unfriend me on Facebook and they send me emails. They just cannot get their heads wrapped around this. And they just say it's too dark and it can't possibly be this wicked. So how do you explain this then?
Well, it's happened with a couple of my family members. And I hate to say it, but people that have an emotional response, you know, to this type of stuff, they're really betraying their consciousness. Now, my family, I have a couple members, they don't get mad, but they'll say things like, one will say, who cares? You know, who cares? And the other, I told him about it, and he told me after I rambled on for a little while, he said, well, the only thing I know for sure is that after the first 15 minutes, I knew that I didn't care. I have to bite my tongue because I want to say, well, which part don't you care about? Killing of another person against their will? Killing of a celebrity against their will? How about maybe you don't care that the most popular guy in the world is replaced and nobody really seems to catch on? But it's clearly not the same guy. And they even know it. They finally admit it. Yeah, I can see the difference, you know. But they don't care.
No, they'll say, well, the music's still great. That's the response I get a lot.
Yeah. Well, if you don't care about his ritual murder, then I guess you don't care about any of the popes getting ritually murdered. You don't care about the ritual murder of 9/11. You don't care about the ritual murder of John F. Kennedy. What do you care about? Daffodils? You know, I don't get it. It's like Spock would say, fascinating, you know?
A lot of people just can't go there, Richard. It's too dark and it's too evil and it's outside of their perception of their reality. People like to believe that they understand their world. They understand their reality. They want to stick it in a box, slap a big bow on it, and that's it. It's defined. They understand it. Don't tell me it's anything different than what I have packaged, because if you do, I'm going to get very upset. I'm going to call you a nut job or a lunatic for even going in certain places. And so that's what's happened when I talk about this whole possibility of McCartney's murder being a satanic ritual. It just really sends a lot of people running for the hills.
One of the biggest keys to why James Paul McCartney was selected to die. Imagine like being born into this world where your future is already predetermined. That's what happened to him. When he was born, his natal sun, the yellow sun, was positioned at 26 degrees in Gemini, the twins. The sun was exactly in opposition to the black hole, supposedly at the center of the Milky Way galaxy, which could be considered a second black sun. And a lot of that, you remember when the Mayan calendar was ticking down on the winter solstice 2012?
Yeah.
Well, that's when the sun was at the galactic womb of the Milky Way galaxy. That's what the ancients, you know, Aztecs and Mayans called it. There's a womb at the galaxy. And then every almost 26,000 years, the sun goes south 13 and then it rises back to that spot. So when James Paul McCartney was born, his son was in opposition to the womb at the Milky Way galaxy, which means from the Earth's position, we are always opposite the sun from our perspective. Wherever the sun is, we're on the opposite side of the zodiac. So what I'm trying to say is at the time that his birth son was in opposition to the womb of the Milky Way galaxy, the Earth itself was exactly conjunct the womb of the Milky Way galaxy at 26 degrees Sagittarius. So, in other words, he picked a really bad day to be born on. And if you even look at where he was born, you want another occult signature? James Paul McCartney was born 99.9 degrees east. Inverted, that's of course 666.
That's interesting because Bill tells us in memoirs that Paul is all about the nines.
Well, if this is correct, and I've got to double check it, there's a 9-11 in the geographic positioning of where he was born. But I got to double check that again. But the 666 is there if you invert the 99.9 degrees east. And then, of course, you take into effect that when he got dead on September 11th, 1966, 13 days after the last Beatles concert, the moon had made exactly 300 orbits of the Earth during the entire lifetime of James Paul McCartney. So is not only the sun and the Earth involved in their positions on the day he was born for his ritual killing, but on the day he died, the same thing's going into effect with the lunar orbits. That's when the three fates who, you know, spin the cloth of life, the thread of life, the first one does, and the second one measures the cord of life, and then the third one cuts it off at the appropriate time. Somebody decided, you know, that was the way to go. Now, Mary Patricia McCartney, his mother, died on Halloween, Samhain. That's also a cross quarter day. It's midway between the fall equinox and the winter solstice. When James Paul McCartney's mother was born on September 29th, 1909, Pluto, the planet of death and regeneration, was located at exactly 26 degrees Gemini, where her son would be born 33 years later. So you see the symbolism there too. The planet of death and regeneration in his mother's birth chart is right at where her son will be born, where her son's son will be born. Somebody thought that was really cool. On top of it, she was born 60 days before a lunar eclipse, which took place November 27th, 1909.
Now, Richard, did you say her birthday was September 29th?
Yeah, she was born September 29th, 1909.
Okay, so September 29th regroups to 9-11. The 2 and the 9 is 11.
Now the student is teaching the master. Good one.
It's just that this 9-11 date, because I get a lot of pushback on that, and folks don't understand it. So I know we'll get into it, but there we go again with his mother, 9-11.
Right. It goes on and on. And then, of course, when we do get to the September 11th portion, we can talk about, you know, the hours and the minutes and how that matters. You know, I don't know if you want to save that or.
We'll go as long as we can go with this 2 hours. And like I said, Richard, we'll do part two, part three, just to get the information out. So no worries about that.
Okay, good, good. So, yeah, whenever you want to cover that, we can cover that.
Okay. And you mentioned that the moped accident, you'd mentioned to me that didn't happen.
No, it happened all right. Let me tell you about it, though. The moped accident is like analogous to the cat playing with the mouse that it knows it's going to kill. It just wants to rough it up and let the mouse think that, well, if I'm clever and I run over here, I could get away or, you know. And you know, see cats do that. They kind of let it get away and then they jump on it. You know, they have a good time. The cat knows it's going to kill the mouse. The mouse doesn't know it. That's what happened with the moped accident. And keep in mind, a cat is a witch's familiar, by the way. From the date of James Paul McCartney's alleged moped accident, which took place December 26, 1965, to the date of his satanic ritual human sacrifice on September 11th, 1966, covers a period of exactly 260 days, counting both dates. 20 times 13 is 260 days. Now, the main point here is this. To the Mayans, the Mayan week lasted 13 days, and there were 20 weeks lasting 13 days each in their Mesoamerican 260-day calendar. So in the Mayan culture, human ritual sacrifice was a sacred offering of nourishment to their gods, you know, the blood sacrifice and such. So to the Mayan high priests, the sacrifice of any living creature was what is known as a blood offering. And the ultimate Mayan blood offering to their deities was when they sacrificed a human life. The most important Mayan rituals of all involved blood offerings that culminated in a human sacrifice. So the 260-day period of time between James Paul McCartney's moped accident and his eventual ritual human sacrifice, 20 weeks of 13 days later, it corresponds to the ancient Mayan culture's blood sacrifice, you know, their whole calendar. It's another indication of a premeditated human sacrifice.
So the moped accident then, according to the Mayan calendar, would be the starting point.
Right.
Right. Day one. And then his actual ritual sacrifice would be the end of what the Mayans considered to be their annual calendar?
Yeah, you could say it that way, but then you could also say, when did this ritual start? Because, you know, it goes back at least to the one-eye symbolism on the second album. It goes back to those black hexagons, you know, in the music segment, And I Love Her. So, you know, it's hard to tell on these where they begin and where they end. But there are certain, you know, key dates along the journey to the get dead part.
So let me phrase it this way then. It almost appears to me that it was almost like a shot across the bow to McCartney. In other words, okay, so we're getting closer to that moment in time where your runway is getting very short.
Right. Now, they might have threatened him and said, you better get your act together. You know, this is your last chance or whatever. But it really wasn't. It was already scheduled. It was going to happen. I can only imagine the nightmares he must have had. You know, at some point he had to know this ain't going the way I thought it was going to go.
Well, this is told in the book. In the book, it's told in the way where Billy tells us that Paul had these recurring dreams and nightmares about his impending death. So a lot of people scoff at that. They say, oh, that's just made up. But in reality, based upon what you're taking us through here, if there is a situation where a ritual was done, he participated in it. I tend to believe also that I've introduced this in the discussion with Mark Devlin, doing more research into it, that it's possible that Paul McCartney was in a mind control program from a very early age. And so these dreams that are spoken about in memoirs could actually be the result of the conditioning and the ritual that he participated in.
Well, you know, that Dr. Richard Allen John Asher, Jane Asher,
yeah,
and Peter Asher's father, he's got to be in this up to his eyeballs. That was the guy that was found, he was missing, you know, for like a week, and then he turns up dead in his basement.
In his own basement. Nobody found him for a week in his own basement.
Wasn't much of a search there.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, he's a strange character. I found out he specialized in, he was an endocrinologist and a hematologist. So on the one hand, he looks at blood, and on the other, he deals with hormones and glands. One of the articles that Dr. Richard Allen John Asher wrote, he wrote a bunch of them, but this one really jumped out. It was called The Sedation and Stimulation of Man. It was published on May 3rd, 1958 in The Lancet. And the opening lines are, people with stress, tension, and irritability feel the need for sedatives. And those with fatigue, apathy, or boredom seek stimulation. So the patient with tension is waiting all the time for something important to happen. I don't seem to be able to relax. I believe the increase of tension, too, is more apparent than real. Now, James Paul McCartney lived with the Ashers starting in 1964. And then I believe memoir says that his dreams, nightmares started like January of 65, like the 29th or somewhere around there. The Express paper, that newspaper that reported that Dr. Asher was missing, reported it in the paper on the Witch's Sabbath, April the 30th, that he was missing. So that was probably another clue to the people that, oh, we're reporting this guy's missing, but those of you in the know, he won't be turning up, you know.
Yep.
And also, Dr. Richard Allen John Asher published a paper on hypnotism. So here we have the guy who admitted he didn't know where he got the idea for the most beautiful song of all time yesterday. He kind of got it in a dream, he said, in parts, you know.
Right.
Maybe this guy's putting sedatives in his food or drink while he's, you know, with Jane and then doing some hypnosis and suggesting, because I could almost hear a witch's chant of yesterday, yesterday, all my troubles far away, yesterday, yesterday. You know what I mean? They love that rhyme stuff. The next thing you know, he's tiptoeing through the tulips, coming up with a great song. It came from somewhere. There's something there that went on. What? I don't know.
Yeah, I agree, Richard, that there's a lot more to this than what most people want to believe.
I don't even believe in the word believe anymore, because the root word of believe is lie. It's right there.
Yeah.
And, you know, beliefs don't mean anything. Facts are what matters. I tell my cousins, everybody, I say, well, what I say is either true or it's not true. Or it's partially true and partially not true. You know, if I made a boo-boo or something. But that's it. That's all it could be. Something's either true or it's not true.
Yeah, I have people who tell me, well, my truth is. I say, well, it's not a truth. Truth is binary. It's either on or off.
Truth is for everybody, yeah. There's no my truth versus your truth.
Right. What you're giving us is, what you're really saying is, this is my perspective. Okay, that's fine. You can have a perspective. So, Richard, let's move a little bit into 9/11 now, because again, there is a debate out there about whether Paul McCartney, for those who believe he died, whether he died in August, September, or November. I have been subscribing to the 9/11 date mostly because of your work and what you've explained to me about what 9/11 means and what it represents. So I know we'll get into this in more detail. Maybe in another show we can really dig in, but can you give us an overview of why 9/11 is so important?
Well, for one thing, it's New Year's Day in the Coptic calendar. The Coptics were the Egyptian nationals who got Christianized. So that's why on September 11th, 2001, the supposed ringleader, Mohammed Atta, he was an Egyptian national. And by the way, his surname of Atta means papyrus swamp in the ancient Egyptian language. September 11th, another key is in the Roman numerals. If you take the Roman numerals for 9 and 11 and you squish them together, you will have that symbol of Baphomet revealed in the 9/11. There is an astronomical significance to both September 11th, 2001 and September 11th, 1966. And that is, in the measurement of the hours of light versus the hours of darkness at that time of the year. So what I'm trying to say is, at that time of the year, there is 11 hours of darkness on the 10th through the 11th before sunrise. 11 hours of darkness, and then there are 14 hours of daylight. So the point is, the extra 2 hours of daylight are 60 plus 60 minutes, while the 11 hours of darkness add up to 660 minutes of darkness. That's what's going on. These black magic occultists, sorcerers, witches, warlocks, politicians, whatever you want to call them, they are worshiping the darkness of 11 hours equaling 660 minutes of darkness on September 11th. That's essentially what's going on.
Okay, and then let's just step back just a little bit, Richard. You mentioned if we take 9/11 and we put it in Roman numeral format, that would be 1X and then X1, right?
Right, and that actually forms the sigil of Baphomet, which is also known as the symbol of heaven and earth, you know.
Okay, so then 9/11, let's see if I got this right, then it is symbolic of Baphomet?
Right. Here it is. You know, if you can see that.
Yes, I can see it. Yep.
And of course, you know, the Baphomet sigil is all over the place.
So is the symbol the two X's coming together? Is that?
Yeah, where one is going up and one is going down and they're going through each other. And then you can think of the ones as the Freemasonic pillars, you know.
Yes.
Joaquin and Boaz, which are sun and moon.
Yeah.
Yeah, that Baphomet is pretty clever.
Okay, so this to me is very important because 9/11 is a date that is associated with Baphomet.
Yeah.
Symbolically.
Going back to at least ancient Rome.
That's very, very important because the question always comes up, why do they constantly use that date? And it's not just for McCartney's death, but 9/11 pops up a lot throughout history.
In movies, especially, and before September 11, 2001. Like in the first Superman movie, I remember they show the Daily Planet. This is the Richard Donner Superman with Christopher Reeve and Margot Kidder.
Yeah.
In the first Superman movie, they show a clock in the Daily Planet newsroom two different times on two supposedly different days, and the both hands point to 9 and 11 each time. In Back to the Future, at the end when Marty goes back to the future, the camera pans back and it shows an 11 in flames, you know, the tire marks going down the middle of the street. But if you look quickly and you can freeze frame it, to the very left of the screen is a neon sign in the form of a 9. So there's a 9/11 there. At the time when Marty first goes to the shopping mall to meet Doc, the time is 1:16 a.m., which is 9/11 inverted. And then on the little hand clocks where Doc does the test on the dog, it shows 119, I think, or 116. Same thing. Another 9/11 reference. And then another big one.
I think it's on the license or passport of the Matrix.
You just hit a grand slam. I mean, it's right there. And that movie, The Matrix, came out in 1999. So that's an amazing coincidence. And also The Big Lebowski, when Jeff Bridges writes the checkout in the grocery store. I think it's for 99 cents or something. It's dated September 11th. Now, you can probably find a bunch of those.
So, Richard, why is Baphomet so important to the occultists? What does it represent?
Well, it's important enough that the first, I think, statue of George Washington, he's in the Baphomet pose, you know, with his shirt off and he's got his right arm up and he's holding an obelisk in his left hand down. So you've got the as above, so below.
Right.
And then an obelisk is actually a dagger. And anywhere in the Bible where they have a phrase, they'll have sometimes a real tiny little dagger, you know, symbol pointed down. And what that means is, you know, they're telling other Masons or whoever in the people in the know, you know, this line's, you know, been altered or whatever.
When we look at Baphomet, is it symbolic of what the occultists would consider to be spiritual alchemy? In other words, as above, so below. And it is the material world versus the spiritual world.
You're exactly 100% correct. It's basically a union of as above, so below is what's going on.
Okay, so again, for the audience, what we're showing here, what Richard's taking us through, is the occult pieces of the puzzle are all over the place. As I mentioned earlier in the show, the planning is well, well in advance. It gives you brain freeze to even think that way, you know, that it's all working this way. It's as if there's some algorithm that's constantly in play.
And it's like the only thing that makes sense makes no sense, but here goes. Maybe the people orchestrating this live a lot longer than we do. It's hard to believe that just like Masonic institutions could just keep churning this stuff out over long periods of time when people grow old and die pretty quickly in the scheme of things, you know. I don't know. But it's clear the evidence says that this stuff is planned out. Probably if we knew how far some of this stuff, you know, it would shock even us.
Richard, does all this stuff go back to the Egyptian mysteries?
Egypt primarily. And it also goes back to when they splintered off and went to the land of Canaan. Because Cain, of course, allegedly killed Abel in the Christian mysteries. And in the Egyptian texts from the Sumerians, there was the first brother and the second brother, you know, got killed by the first brother, the first murder. So Canaan is actually the land of the first murderer that he was banished to, that he went. And that's what they're fighting over today, you know, with Israel and Palestine and all that in there. Everybody's fighting over the lands of the first murderer on planet Earth. And apparently that must mean a real big deal to some people.
Did you want to talk a little bit about, you sent me some emails about Abbey Road and the obelisk at Abbey Road. Is this something that we could talk about, or did you want to save that for part two?
Oh, whatever. I just got onto that because I wanted to see that witch's crosswalk there. I just wanted to see what else was around, you know, because we're always looking at this going north. And then we know that the EMI is over on the left and they're crossing the street. So I just went to Google Earth and I just wanted to see what else was around there, you know, other directions. And lo and behold, you spin the camera around, there's a big obelisk there. And I still can't get any straight data on how tall that thing is. I can't find it anywhere online. I'll have to go to the library on that one. So I started looking at the monument. It's called the Edward Onslow Ford Memorial. And this guy was a incredible sculptor. He's so good, he makes Michelangelo look like a kid. And his stuff is so incredibly lifelike, you almost start to think, is this like a house of wax thing going on where they're, you know, killing kids and then, you know, molding, you know, the dead body to make these? Because the expressions on the people's face, it's unbelievable. If you look at some of his work, you'll be amazed. And he does a lot of stuff with Egyptian. I think he did Queen Victoria. I think he did her sculpture. Some of them are like supposedly little nymphet girls because they're starting to bud breasts. But if you look real close at the face, they don't look like little girls there. They look like little boys, you know, and I don't want to get weird here, but see if you see that, you know, I see it. I mean, you know, maybe I'm wrong or ate up in the head on that, but there's something weird going on with this guy. But his obelisk being so close to the Abbey Road crosswalk and the studio at number 3 Abbey Road. And then right where that crosswalk is a fork in the road. And witches' forks, just like witches' crossroads, are very big deals. See, the main thing with witchcraft is it's all essentially boils down to spells to banish something or someone, or spells to bring something into manifestation. I realized pretty quick that not only is Abbey Road a fork, but it's a witch's fork. And if you go south on Abbey Road, it winds down to like 3 magic circles that start with, it's called the Marble Arch. And the Marble Arch looks exactly like the Palmyra Arch of Baal, kind of like the Arc de Triomphe in Paris. Looks to me like it's another Baal gateway. Well, anyway, you go through that Marble Arch and you hit these 3 other magic circles, and the street will jog a little bit and it will have name changes, and it doesn't exactly hook up in the modern day, but you could tell the energy or whatever goes right through the front door of Buckingham Palace, and then it goes out the back door of Buckingham Palace. And it all goes down to a focal point called Belgravia, which essentially means the way to Bell's grave, or, you know, I mean, there's not too many ways you can interpret that. Now, another kinky thing on that witch's fork is if from Abbey Road to the obelisk, if you go to the right side, Abbey Road is on the left side of the witch's fork, which is the left-hand path. On the right-hand path, that road, which is called Grove End Road, I think, that road right by the train station to the east changes into Acacia Street. And Acacia is a whole death and resurrection plant unto itself in the Masonic mysteries, in the ancient Egyptian mysteries. And there is a species, there are 28 species of Acacia, which corresponds to that license plate on the Beatle that says, what, 28 if?
Yeah.
So there's 28 different types of Acacia. It's like a tree or a bush. And Acacia has spikes on it that look like obelisks. And on Paul McCartney's new album, he's standing with two Acacia plants on each side. And you can see the the obelisk-like spikes on it. And of course, they have a white or a yellow ball flower on it. And so there you get your sun symbolism.
What's a witch's fork, Richard, so that I understand in the audience?
It's basically one energy splitting. And you have a choice to go here or here. And a crossroad is the opposite. You have two things that can come together, X's.
But a witch's fork, then you mentioned left-handed path, right-handed path.
Right.
So you can go one way or the other.
Right.
Okay. Now, I think for this show, we should probably, the last topic we should talk about is the scarab beetle. The name of the beetles themselves, Beatles versus Beetles, the scarab beetle. And it's very interesting. Aleister Crowley wrote a book called The Winged Beetle. And for those that are following the McCartney conspiracy, we know that there was a movie that was put out, I believe it was put out by I Am a Phony, I hope I'm right on that, called The Winged Beetle. There is, in my view, no coincidence that Aleister Crowley has a book called The Winged Beetle, and then a documentary comes out about Billy playing the part of Paul McCartney titled The Winged Beetle. So, in my view, these things come together and mean something.
Right. Now, the scarab beetle that goes back to ancient Egypt, it became famous because the scarab beetles push these dung balls around, and then they lay their eggs and have their kids come out of it, and they eat it too or whatever. But the Egyptians noticed that they would be pushing these little balls all over the place at sunrise when the sun came up. So the Egyptian scarab beetle, where it's like got the sun in the middle, you know, on a lot of crests and hieroglyphs, was the symbol for the rising sun. And then in their mythology, the dung beetle pushes the ball over the horizon. You know, the sun sets, and then the dung beetle, you know, pushes the ball in the underworld until the next morning, you know, when the sun rises and he's pushing the ball again. And the interesting thing on why a beetle, why would a band named the Beatles be considered the greatest rock band group of all time? A couple of different occult meanings there. One is the very name Beatles is an anagram of both Set and Bale, B-A-E-L and S-E-T. Set was the personification of wickedness in ancient Egypt, who killed Osiris, the first dying resurrection god. And then Bale, you know, goes back to Bale. B-A-A-L, B-A-E-L, or bell. You ring a bell in a church. If you're getting shot down in a war, you bail out. If you go to see the judge and get out of jail, you post bail. If your boat is taking on water, what do? You bail out the water. You know, the other thing, occult signature that ties into the sigil of Baphomet, the symbol of heaven and earth, is the very fact that the beetles have six legs. These are mandibles, I think, but when you look at it, it looks like horns. But the sigil of Baphomet is actually there if you extend the legs inward each way.
The double X.
It's right there. It's there, but it's hidden, you know?
Yeah, no, I see it. Very, yeah, it's really interesting.
And also tied into Moloch, because that's another name for Bel. Baal, Bel, Baal is also tied. It's the same name, a different name for Moloch. And Moloch was the owl, like the owl at Bohemian Grove.
Right.
Moloch, there were children's sacrifices to. And Moloch gets its name from Moloch, which goes back once again to the ancient Egyptian nationals that were Christianized, the Coptics. That's where it goes back to. And all the hieroglyphs in ancient Egypt, all of them are always shown in profile, going one way or the other. And that was the direction you read the letters from. Whichever way it's facing, you read from that way. Well, the only Egyptian hieroglyph letter that faces right out directly at you is the letter M. And the letter M in the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs was an owl that the Coptics called Moloch, which became Moloch, and it's a horned owl. The Egyptian letter for F is a horned viper, snake. So the Egyptians were big on the horns, you know, for whatever reason. They love them.
So, Richard, as we wrap up part one here, what is your opinion with regard to the Beatles ever having been organic? Do you believe they were organic at one time, or do you believe that the Beatles were always on the radar, put together, we'll say, by Tavistock, and put together in an occult fashion as magic, as a spell? You probably have better words than I do. What's your opinion on that?
Well, I think for that, we should go to this one page that opens the phenomenology of the Beatles. I hate to say it. At one point, obviously, all of us are organic, you know, obviously.
Exactly. Right.
However, right. From the very first meeting between Paul McCartney, the real one, and John Lennon, it took place on July the 6th, 1957. James Paul McCartney meets John Winston Lennon for the first time when the former sees the Quarrymen play at St. Peter's Church, Garden Fete in Liverpool. Now, the question here is, who works in a quarry? Quarrymen? Who works in a quarry and are known as the Quarrymen? The answer is stonecutters and Freemasons. So the next question is, well, what do quarrymen do? The answer is they cut and they extract stone and rock. Well, rock can mean rock band, and stone in Latin means petrum. Petra is another name for rock or stone, like petroglyphs, you know. Now, Petra is the feminine form of the name Peter also, where they meet, St. Peter, St. Petra. Now, here's the other thing. Not only does Petra mean rock or stone, but in voodoo, which goes way back, predates any religion, there were two types of gods in voodoo. There are the Loa, L-O-A, and those are the benevolent spirits. I guess I shouldn't call them gods. They're more benevolent spirits. And then the evil spirits are known as the Petra. So keeping in mind that Peter Petra can mean stone or voodoo, the bad spirits, it's interesting that St. Peter founded the Catholic Church on this rock. So everybody who reads that thinks he's talking about a piece of hard rock or a foundation stone or something like that. But what they're really saying to the people in the know is it was founded on voodoo. It was founded on Petra. It was founded on witchcraft. And upon the Petra, I will build my church. You know, this is the worst kind of conspiracy. It's actually not a conspiracy. The whole Paul is dead thing is a realization, you know. It's no longer a conspiracy theory. Okay, now, this is James McCartney's natal horoscope.
This is Paul's dad?
This is Paul's biological father, allegedly. He's born July 7th, 1902. Astronomically speaking, although the day, the calendar day date is off by one Gregorian calendar day, so that won't line up. But astronomically speaking, James McCartney's son, James Paul McCartney, meets John Lennon exactly 55 years later after his father's birth. On July 6, 1957, they meet when the sun is once again exactly conjunct the sacred star Sepsothis Sirius A at midnight at 13 degrees Cancer on the day that John Lennon and Paul McCartney officially meet, 55 years exactly to the day after James McCartney's birth, Paul's father. So I think he was the one that set it up through the church, maybe working with John Lennon's dad, because somebody on the official Beatles sites, they say that someone in the family did a wink and a nudge to the church to let John play. And probably the other father, James, said, hey, why don't you go up there and take your guitar up to that church social and, you know, see what's going on up there. Because the fact that they meet 55 years, you know, exactly astronomically with the whole sacred star, you know, at 13 degrees at midnight, that's just a little bit too coinky-dink.
Yeah, so this goes hand in hand with what I surmise, Richard, which is that biological Paul's father, Jim McCartney, was a Freemason, and I suspected a high-level Freemason. And also, when you go to do research on Jim McCartney, this is biological Paul's dad, the background on him is very sketchy. It looks like there's a lot of stuff missing. You don't get a lot about him. What did he do for a living and stuff like that? It's very, very suspect. And then on Lennon's side of the house, his dad is not really even in the picture. And we get the same thing when you try to investigate what his father was or who he was about. You really can't nail it down and get a lot of specifics. So on both sides, on Paul's side and John's side, the fathers are enigmas in my view. Very difficult to really ascertain who they were and, you know, what they did and where did they go and all that stuff.
And the absence of evidence is itself evidence, you know, just like patterns or proof. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And again, folks, I'm just saying that looking at this, my radar goes up. So I'm not making any allegations or assertions. I'm just saying that this is more that we need to look at. There's more stuff that we need to look for.
Oh, guess where the sun was on the day at midnight that Mal Evans was murdered? By a policeman.
Yep.
And we know policemen belong to a fraternal order.
Yep.
The sun was positioned at 13 degrees Capricorn and was in opposition to the sacred star, Sepsothis Sirius.
You know, it's mind-boggling, Richard, to even think how this all comes together. The planning behind this, the dates, the celestial bodies, the astrology is just mind-numbing.
Well, here's another one if you want to freak out your mind even more. The last two eclipses before September 11th, 2001, the last solar eclipse happened on the summer solstice before September 11th, and the last lunar eclipse happened on July the 5th, 2001, when the sun was positioned at 13 degrees Cancer and was also exactly conjunct the sacred star Sepsothis Sirius. So the last lunar eclipse took place conjunct the sacred star before the mass ritual human sacrifice known as 9/11.
Yeah, unbelievable.
I don't even like to say that word anymore, and I say it all the time. I'm trying to break myself of the habit because it's like, dang it, it is believable, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it's like you're training yourself not to believe it when you say that. Like you're programming yourself, you know? We are the programming. It's not what we watch on TV.
I've gotten over a lot of hurdles, Richard. I really have. But, you know, sometimes, like I said, some of the stuff hurts your head. When you think about the magnitude of what's going on and what's taking place and the hidden hand of reality, All I can say, folks, is you have to open your mind. You have to give up on holding on to your denial and holding on to what you believe, what you've been told throughout your life is true, because what we've been told is not true. Our reality is very, very different from what we have been taught and shown.
Yeah, I get that feeling too sometimes, but what that is, it's actually your consciousness is expanding. Because your awareness has increased. It's like a muscle. Suddenly, you know, a bunch of profound truths that you didn't like an hour or so before. And that only happens to someone who can keep an open mind to this stuff. There's basically going to be three types of people that react to this information. There's going to be the people that do keep their mind open and start to become archaeocultologists themselves. And then there'll be the people that are like the second coming of Sam Kinison. They'll be screaming.
Yeah.
And then the third people will be the people that go, say that again. Hopefully there'll be a lot more of the open-minded people. Because truth is the only growth industry. Hollywood has made every type of movie you can make except the truth. There's only so many people that can run around in spandex saving the world. You know?
Yeah.
And here we are saving the world by trying to hip people to the street lingo of the Satanists and the occultists. And then you get those people that, you know, why is that important? Who cares?
No, it really is disconcerting when people remark that way. But you know what, Richard, what I've done is I've just moved on. I don't do this to evangelize, and I don't do this to try to convince anybody. I do this to put the information out, to present my findings, my research with my guests like yourself. And we just put it out there. If it resonates with you, fine. If it doesn't, fine. Years ago, I tried to get people to see and to understand, but I can't open your eyes if you don't want to open your eyes. I can't make you hear if you don't want to hear. So I'm not going to bang my head against the wall. I'm just going to put it out there. If it resonates with you, then great. If it doesn't, that's okay too.
It's kind of like the lemming syndrome. I always wonder about that last lemming. You know, they kill themselves by jumping off the cliff, all of them en masse. And I always wonder if I was that last, you know, last one, would I jump? If I saw everybody else jump to their deaths, you know, you would think it would say, oh, maybe I'll just go get a snack over here or something, you know? Or now I got the whole place to myself, you know? I don't know. I don't get it. This whole planet is like a playpen of insanity. Isn't that some lyric in some song? I mean, it really is. It's, quite a ride here, because there's three types of souls incarnate on the earth at this time, according to Nostradamus. You've got the thrill seekers, the people, the souls that love roller coasters and, oh yeah, let's go down when the Antichrist is getting ready to come. That'll be really wild. And then you've got the old souls that are here to kind of get the survivors through, you know,
yep,
to kind of show them a little light through the darkness. And then there's the souls that are just so wicked and bad that this is their last hurrah, you know, and most of them don't know it. You know, they think they can just carjack, kill, rape, you know, do anything horrible just because that's their reality. And really, it's their last chance. It's your last wake up call. This place is like a way station for the soul. Life is all about, to me, is finding out your own true nature. We don't know how we'd react in certain situations or whatnot, but I think the big guy, God or whatever you want to call him, the only way he, she, or it, or whatever it is, could learn something new if it was all omnipotent was to just break off little pieces of its own consciousness and send it out and disperse it, and then it all comes back, you know, with the stories of this lifetime or this, you know, and that's the only way that maybe the divine oneness could to grow or learn something new or just because really that's all it is. It's all consciousness. That's all we are. You know, this is just a shell we're walking around in. And when you die, the body immediately gets cold. Why? Because the heat generator, the soul, is detached now.
So, Richard, I just want to cover this before we head out. Now, you have your first book, On Earth as It Is in Heaven. It's not in production anymore.
Right, out of print.
Out of print. Great book. But you have a new book coming out, and it's called Beatle Satanica.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you could just tell us a little bit about that, when you think it'll be ready and all that.
Not soon enough, I tell you that. Because I'm only really on my research right up to the start of 1963. Now, I've done some other key dates, you know, here or there, of course. But as far as chronology of the Beatles phenomena and the Beatles, you know, that's one part of it. Well, I'd like to have it out on James Paul McCartney's birthday as kind of his revenge, you know, but I know I won't make it this year because I want to do it well. We have to be as great as the Beatles were to solve this whole Beatles, you know, satanic ritual, human sacrifice. We have to be as great as Edward Onslow Ford, you know, the sculptor. And you are. You have taken this whole thing light years. You know, you really have. You're indelibly in, whether you like it or not, Beatles lore from the enlightening that you've and others, your other people you work with in that. Chilock Holmes, he's amazing. He single-handedly redeemed my faith in like the next generation. You know, I had kind of given up on him.
A lot of people said that about Nick. They said, thank God.
Yeah.
They're not all sitting in front of their television playing video games.
Right.
And being tranced out, yeah. Well, I have to tell you, Richard, you know, I'm involved in it, but, you know, I've done a lot of research on my own, but I'm really the communicator. It's people like yourself. And as I mentioned, there are probably around a half dozen folks who, over the last 2.5 years, have sent me information and have shared information that has been very, very good. The quality has been outstanding. So I'm just a person that is actually doing my own research, but also an aggregator for folks like yourself, Richard, who have contributed to putting the pieces of the puzzle together on this McCartney conspiracy.
Right, but don't sell yourself short, Sage, because first you've got that great open mind. You know, you just want to know the information. You'll pick out the gold nuggets here or there when you find them. And that's the hardest thing. But also your demeanor, because you're not like hyperbolic or, you know, get all revved up on certain aspects. You're cool, calm, and collected. And very precise, you know, I learned that with your outlines, you know, and that's invaluable in something as vast as this, because most conspiracies, there's hardly any occult evidence, really. You have to really dig for it. It's there, but this, there's clues everywhere, all kinds of clues. There's almost too many clues, and people still don't believe it, a lot of people.
The number of clues is overwhelming. It really is. And people sometimes will send information to me and say, Mike, have you seen this? I'm thinking, oh my God, not another one. I'm like, no, I haven't seen that.
I know. I'm so waiting for your timeline. I can't wait for that.
Yeah, the timeline will come in June. It's going to be a massive amount of work to do, Richard, to put the whole thing together. But there's something inside of me that is just telling me, do it, Mike. You have to do it. Put it together. Lay it out there. And so I will. Now, Richard, are there any websites or anything that people can catch up with you, or is it essentially going to be your books?
No, they can Gmail me if they want to do that. You can give my Gmail out.
All right, Richard. Thank you so much again. Thank you for the kind words, too. And we will catch up very, very soon.
All right. Great, Sage. Great rapping with you. And what an amazing, amazing story this is.
And that concludes another Sage or Quay interview. And I hope you enjoyed the discussion as much as I did. Links to my guests' websites and social media are listed in the description box below. And as always, I would like to thank everyone for listening and visiting the blog. You can find all my social media and web links by visiting my hub website at sageofquay.com. Also, if you get a moment, please visit laboroflovemusic.com to check out my music and album releases. And remember, live in truth and always serve creation. It's really that simple. See everyone with the next show. Be safe, enjoy, and God bless.